Good evening and welcome to the second 2016 Sir John Monash. Sorry? Oh, it's the third. Oh, the no, it's the second series, isn't it? It's the third of the second series. So we've had many. The Sir John Monash Distinguished Public Lecture Series. And this lecture series provides Monash University Malaysia an opportunity to engage with you, the community in Malaysia, and also the region, through the promotion of thought leadership in key areas that are strategic to the development of the region in the 21st century, something which I hope you will all share with me and think is a very important objective. And this lecture series takes its inspiration from Sir John Monash, and he is considered to be one of Australia's most distinguished citizens, scholars and leaders, and he's a person who sought to use his education and abilities for the benefit of the community. And this is something that as Monash we try to train our students to do. So the public lecture series covers a wide variety of contemporary and interdisciplinary topics that will be presented by high profile thinkers such as Professor Rebekah Brown, who we welcome here today. Their work has made a significant impact to the global community. And today we're very fortunate to have Professor Brown here, and she'll present the third Sir John Monash public lecture for the theory for the year on a topic titled Realising Sustainable Water Management in Cities. I'm sure you all know that water is actually the planet's most precious resource and probably the least appreciated, and human pressures on our supplies of clean water are increasing daily. I'm sure you're very keen to hear her today on the latest interdisciplinary research across the social and physical sciences and practical examples of sustainable urban water management. Before we commence the lecture, I'd like to just introduce Professor Brown. She's currently director of the Monash Sustainability Institute, which is a leading interdisciplinary research and education centre, and it works with the government, industry and philanthropists to promote the knowledge and practice of sustainable development. She co-founded the Water Sensitive Cities Research Platform at Monash University with the aim to find sustainable solutions to global urban water challenges. She was instrumental in the establishment of the Cooperative Research Centre for Water Sensitive Cities, comprising 86 partner organisations and over 170 researchers. And she was its chief research officer and the program leader. Not surprisingly, with such an enormous institute, she's published over 100 papers, including papers in Nature and Science, so I'm very jealous, with this aim to support the development of more livable, resilient and sustainable cities. And if you just go outside and have one look at the sorry state of the Klang River flowing near Monash, it will prove that we really need her here in Kuala Lumpur. So I'd like to welcome Professor Brown and hope that we can all learn from her address today to realise sustainable water management in Kuala Lumpur and beyond. Thank you very much, Rebekah.
Thank you very much for that warm welcome, and there's a number of people here in the audience that I've met over the last 2 days and I've been made to feel very welcome. So I thank you all, and it's a true honour to be able to give this Sir John Monash lecture. Now, I've been asked to speak for 60 minutes and I thought, wow, could you all sit there in the evening and listen to me for 60 minutes? So I've tried to make it a little bit shorter than 60 minutes, but what I will do is I will gauge how you are all going, and if I think you're getting a bit tired, I'll speed up a bit. So we'll see how we go. I'm Professor of Social Science, but I'm also a civil engineer. So this is where the language of socio-technical comes from. And I'm an academic, but I have a private sector consultancy background. And my view is that if we want a more sustainable future, we need to understand some of the technical and infrastructure solutions, but we need to understand our fellow communities and our fellow societies and what works for them culturally. And in fact, we need biophysical and socioeconomic strategies that work well. We need strategies that improve the environment. We need strategies that not only improve the environment, that bring about fundamental social inclusion. to make sure that we leave no one behind. We also need solutions that contribute to economic prosperity. We can't have environmental solutions and social inclusion solutions that don't also contribute to economic productivity. Everyone has a right to a good job, to meaningful work, and contributing to society. And so we need those three pillars, but that needs to be underpinned by good governance, governance that's transparent, and governance that promotes peace and security for all. So what I'm actually sharing with you is a vision about a sustainable world. And I think that knowledge institutions and universities and our future generation of students play a really important part in shaping what is sustainable development today and what it is for tomorrow. And we all have a role in creating that. Tonight I'm going to talk about water specifically, because that's my personal research area. But at Monash Sustainability Institute, our focus is broader, and it is about that broad sustainable development agenda. You may not have seen these goals. These are 17 global goals for 2030. These were all signed off by all heads of states, governments, even some of the youngest nations like South Sudan, about what we want to achieve for our world by 2030. And to get all heads of governments and nation states to sign up to, because there's too many, it'd be ideal if there were 10 goals, but to sign up to 17 goals is a huge feat. And tonight I'm going to talk probably mostly about goal 6, goal 11, and I'm also going to talk about goal 13, climate action. So cities, we're all familiar with issues in cities. Congestion, huge population growth and density, issues around provision of sanitation, and challenges around fair and inclusive productivity. What are we seeing in cities? The urban heat island effect. Cities are hotter. They don't have enough water and greenery in the landscape. So the urban heat island, exacerbated by climate change, is significant. Cities flood. Cities face drought. There are significant public health phenomena that happens as a consequence of living in very dense urban environments. And we know that we've got a big job in front of us of keeping global warming down by the end of the century to less than 2 degrees. So COP21 in Paris last year, at the end of last year, the aim to keep our world to under a 2 degree increase by the end of the century is a massive challenge. We look like we're on the pathway of a 4 to 6 degree increase. We're already seeing various ice sheets melting and vulnerable. We know that the Pacific Islands in particular are vulnerable to sea level rise. We're going to have not so much refugees from wars. What we're anticipating in the second half of this century is environmental refugees from the effects of climate change. So to really alleviate that, it's a global challenge. Australia, where I'm from, the city of Melbourne, we are just as challenged as Kuala Lumpur as a city in how we're going to be smart in reducing our emissions. These are huge challenges. And water, why is water such a problem for cities? With the effects of climate change, we have more droughts now than ever before, more floods, and significant amount of pollution. And in fact, what engineers used to be able to do, we used to be able to predict cyclic floods and droughts, part of the normal seasonality of the planet. But with the exacerbated effects of climate change, we now accept that it's unpredictable and we need to be resilient. These are big, big challenges. So in some sense, I'm going to focus on urban water, and urban water affects all parts of our lives in a city, and I'm going to attempt to try and argue why that is the case. These are those 17 sustainable development goals, and we've got clean water and sanitation in the middle. But it leads to good health and well-being. In fact, clean water and sanitation is critical for urban agriculture, leading to that goal number 2, zero hunger. Life below water, our aquatic ecosystems. Cities, having a sustainable city, can't have a sustainable city without sustainable water environments. If we think out here about reduced inequalities, no poverty, gender equality, we know that for many developing cities, women have to walk, you know, 6-8 hours to collect water. So they're not working. They're not operating in society. We know for actually one of my colleagues is doing a study throughout Africa and trying to understand, even when there are policies for school, for girls to go to school, why aren't they going to school? They don't have sanitation, don't have latrines, don't have toilets. So, you know, in fact, clean water and sanitation has a big impact on gender inequality. In Australia, most senior positions in the water sector are all held by men, white men, usually about 60. Very few roles for women. So gender inequality is a shared issue around the world. So water is connected to all of these global sustainable development goals. This here is a continuum of water development in cities around the world, and different cities are at different stages. Most cities, especially at the start of the Industrial Revolution, most European cities focused on what's this called this water supply city, building big pipe approaches to bringing in water for population growth. And when people started congregating in cities, cholera and typhoid, major public health epidemics, started to become a phenomena. And when the rise of epidemiology and all these other sciences became realised, we realised people were getting sick because they were drinking dirty water rather than, you know, not being good people and so on and so forth. And these first three city states, you'll see this in Kuala Lumpur and you'll see this in Melbourne and you'll see this in other places, really water management reflects this type of engineering solution. And what myself and many colleagues have been arguing, and this is Monash research, is that we need to be focusing on solutions that deliver social amenity and environmental health, intergenerational equity and resilience to climate change, which is this water-sensitive city. And I'm going to talk a little bit about a journey of getting to that. So let's focus on these first three city states. The big pipe solution. This is a solution that is still prosecuted around the world. The World Bank and Asian Development Bank and others fund this for city development. And so what we do is we look for creeks and waterways, and streams. We often put them underground, put them in a pipe, rip out all the biological diversity and have it functioning very efficiently. It's good for jobs, it's good for public works planning, and it brings water in quickly to a city. We use it, we make it dirty, and we send it out. It's also contributed to cities having good economic productivity and reducing public health impacts. But of course, it has huge environmental and social consequences. You'll see in developing cities, there's been this language called the WASH programs. So they can't afford necessarily the big pipes, but these cities will come in and build latrines and try and provide some sort of water servicing. But if you have a look here, this woman's working here on this big pipe, it does not address fundamentally environmental pollution. We go back to this framework and the Asian... This is some work that myself and another colleague published some years ago, and it's now being used by the Asian Development Bank to inform future strategies and inform what they're using to set up low-cost loans for poor communities around water. And so the question is, Are these sorts of big pipe infrastructure approaches, is that what we want to be doing going forward for city building? And it really does disconnect people from the water environment. You know, we turn the tap on, we're not really connected to our environment the way that we engineer water systems. So then it's not front of mind. We don't think about our behaviours, and we don't think about that as a fundamental source for celebration and for community and for well-being. So these are places, developing and developed cities, where there's been the big pipes approach. This here, this picture here, you might want to have a look at. You'll see this on the outskirts of cities, Australian cities everywhere. And these were once beautiful, thriving rivers. All the biological diversity has been engineered out. Trapezoidal concrete channels have been put into the environment for the efficient delivery of floodwater that's highly contaminated. And what's interesting is communities are now saying they're ugly. We don't want them. What's happened to our platypus? That's a conversation in Melbourne. What's happened to our platypus, a beautiful animal that lives in these waterways? The community conversation is changing. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about at Monash University, so our university, some real innovation in what we call green infrastructure to try and address some of these problems. Because quite often these this pollution is treated through energy-hungry treatment plants. So they're treatment plants that rely on a lot of fossil fuels that emit a lot of greenhouse gas emissions. So basically we clean up most of these challenges by using a lot of fossil fuels and increasing emissions. So it's a perverse cycle. So at Monash, particularly in the engineering department, the last 15 years has been looking at how can we have green infrastructure, use nature's plants and soils to clean water. So when it rains and it falls on the ground and it's dirty, or when you flush the toilet and you've got dirty water, how could you put it through a natural engineered system that uses no fossil fuels, that relies on photosynthesis and absorption of dirty chemicals in the processes to clean water? And so these systems, this is a picture of them in the laboratory. And another innovation from Monash University is this porous pavement. And I think in KL this would be fantastic because you've got roads and everywhere and lots of concrete everywhere. And these porous pavements have got holes in them, so water can percolate through them and you can harvest all the water underneath as a supply and you can treat it and clean it, not using fossil fuels. So it's actually like a dam or a catchment under your roads, under our roads. So those infrastructure, green infrastructure showed you in the laboratory, they're now built all over Singapore. So Singapore had the Marina Barrage project, so they turned their Marina Barrage into a freshwater system because they didn't want to be dependent on Malaysia anymore for all their water supply. And so they said, but actually, if we're going to use all our rainfall that falls on our city, we better clean it as it falls on the ground. So they've used Monash green infrastructure technology, and this is in construction. So as the water falls, it gets treated and cleaned naturally before it goes into Marina Barge and used as a water supply. And they're more beautiful. We've built these systems in Israel, and Israel's been interested in cleaning the water through no fossil fuel approach and injecting it in the ground when it's wet, and then using and taking the water out when it's dry when they need it. And they're also interested in how this green infrastructure can make their environments more beautiful. So if you have a look at this system here, and these are the systems that we're building down here, and it provides for cooling, it provides for recreation, and it's more beautiful. So the question is then, and I'm going to get to the social science part soon. The question is, you know, we've got these sort of proof of concept green infrastructure that's being built around the world and in this region. The question is transitioning to an alternative way of thinking about cities. And how do we do that? So these green infrastructure, Monash University has moved from focusing on just the horizontal, we've now been developing vertical infrastructure. So this idea that maybe the wastewater from a building can be treated on the walls of a building, and the buildings become more beautiful, and the buildings themselves are a cooling mechanism for the city. We now have these living walls as another way of envisaging what a city could provide. Also helps deal with the effects, the respiratory effects of a lack of greening in an urban environment, because cities aren't going away. This here is a very, very simple schematic. I have lots of them for multi-storey buildings. But this is the idea, if you think from your hand basin and from your bathroom, collecting that water, treating it on the outside of your wall while also providing a source of water for plants and for cooling, and then using it for other purposes. What's happening in Australia is that this here is treating all the runoff off Bourke Street. Bourke Street's the main thoroughfare through the CBD of Melbourne, Australia. And artists, public artists, actually this is a New Zealand artist who did this piece of urban art. It's now part of art. Green infrastructure in Australia is now part of art. And so you know you've got to add a tipping point if the artists are starting to use that infrastructure and technology in a cultural and artistic way. And this here is a picture of looking at, you wouldn't think this is all engineering. This is engineering of the future. I know when I was taught engineering, I was taught to do concrete and designing all this infrastructure that was so ugly. And this is like the engineering of the future. Engineering has caused a lot of problems in cities in terms of using a lot of resources and increasing the amount of emissions, but engineering can be absolutely critical to finding solutions as well. But it's not just engineering. This here is, just to show at Monash University, the increase in disciplines that have been involved in urban water research from a multi-interdisciplinary perspective. In the 90s, it was engineering and ecology working together. In 2004, the social scientists got together and said, this is actually a social problem, and had a big program on that. Then the social scientists and the engineers got together and said, this is a socio-technical problem, and started innovating these green technologies. And then the chemists and the economists and the landscape architects were pretty cranky. They said, we need to be part of this solution. And you can see, and planning. And as you can see, the research funding grew. And then we won a couple of years ago this very large cooperative research centre, a national research centre. And I've only had room on this slide to show a number of the, but it's actually over 20 disciplines. And we finally got the humanities involved, the anthropologists and the historians, helping us understand place and how people feel about their place and the cultural aspirations they have for their place. And when you ask people what their aspirations are for their cities and place, it reflects the philosophy of sustainable development. We have 85 partners in this project. National University of Singapore here, many partners across Australia because it's a national research centre, and some European partners. We want to expand that. So what I'm going to do now is, you might think, well, what is this water-sensitive city? What is this water-sensitive city? And so, I'm fine now, thank you. So we spent some time working with our art and design students at Monash in Melbourne, and we got them to prepare a visual flyover so that we could share a vision of a water-sensitive city. And I'm really proud of these students. I took a couple of the photos that are in this video, so that made me feel good that they thought they were good enough to include. So I'll just get started and I'll just talk a little bit through it. So this is a fly-in to the city of Melbourne, and it's going to show you how we've set up this National Research Centre. And the music was chosen by Monash students, made all the academics nervous for a while. So these are some of the teams that we have. We have engineers, and we have ecologists working on the project. That's some of the laboratories that I showed you earlier. People are looking at all sorts of interesting things. We've got a whole lot of industry workshops happening. That's the CEO of the CRC. We've got young people going out into the field doing all sorts of interesting things. So this is funded by the Australian government. And now we're going to fly in. So this is the CBD of Melbourne, and this is a vision of a water-sensitive city. So you can see there we've got the green spine up the middle, and the idea is to provide fit-for-purpose water supply, to recycle water as much as possible, and to provide an environment that delivers more ecosystem services in an urban setting. And urban biodiversity is critical to that, and the idea of beauty, communities caring about their place. So we're now flying in and you're seeing green infrastructure everywhere, and you're seeing water being kept in the landscape rather than being pushed away. This is one of our green walls as an idea of thinking about how we could live more within our means. So now we're flying through. This is flood water that would normally be taken away. This is being kept in the landscape in an artistic way, but being treated all the time through a low energy approach. It's about encouraging people to be active and to connect with their environment and to really embrace the idea of art in the urban landscape. And of course, what's beautiful in one place might not be beautiful in another. What we learnt in Singapore is that sort of messy green look that the Australian culture likes. In Singapore, they like it to look more manicured and to have more flowers and more colour in these systems. So it's variable. And so now we're flying over, and you know, this is some of the road systems, and now we're looking at how can we co-generate energy through wastewater production. This is an urban orchard, so most cities generate more water, than more net water providers than what they take. This is a tri-generation system that's looking at the providing reticulated hot water and through the wastewater heat generating energy. This is a productive, that's my photo, that's my local grocer. That's in Melbourne, in Paran, and these are the ideas that you can generate food from your local urban environment. And so the idea is that once you start demonstrating this way of thinking about a city, then as a city develops, you start introducing this green technology and new ways of thinking about your city and connecting to your city. Okay, so UNESCO took our work, that continuum, and decided to map over 30 cities, 15 developing and 15 developed around the world, and said, where are you in terms of your water management? And they brought the local mayor, usually the city engineer, but it could have been the sort of strategist, they brought them all to The Hague for a four-day workshop and got them to map where they were. And what they found is cities that are from a developing city context were often at the very end of this continuum. And developed cities, cities like Melbourne and Sydney, were stuck somewhere in the middle. They were throwing in green technologies and throwing in more sustainable development programs, but found it very difficult to transition because of the historical institutional and infrastructure investments. And that led to a whole lot of sort of other thinking about, well, do developed cities actually have a lot more to learn from developing cities in this context? And my colleague, Peter Newton, did a piece of research looking at the ecological footprint of cities per capita, so the amount of emissions and environmental resources we all use as individuals, versus livability. How livable are these cities in terms of jobs and well-being and health and so on and so forth? And it was interesting what was found. Australian cities actually have the highest livability, one of the highest livabilities in the world. But if you have a look down here, our ecological footprint, our emissions per capita, is just crazy bad, really bad. American cities have less livability than Australian cities, but have a worse ecological footprint. Middle Eastern cities, again, lower livability, higher ecological footprint. European cities sit somewhere here. They've got a lower ecological footprint than Australian cities and higher livability. Many, not all, but many Asian cities are down here. Low per capita ecological footprint, but lower livability. And the problem is that for many strategies, city building strategies in the Asian and Latin American regions, the plan is to do this. The plan is to be up there. But the opportunity for Asian and Latin American cities to grow and develop, increase livability, but to keep that ecological footprint down is here right now through making smart decisions about city planning. So this is where all these cities here and the cities I'm from, we've got a lot to learn about what could potentially happen here. So we have this hypothesis that there's a developing cities potentially have a better chance of becoming and leapfrogging to a water-sensitive city than technologically and institutionally locked-in developed cities. And this has led to a whole realm of research. And so we've had a look at why developed cities are finding it difficult to transition. And we examined 43 large international studies around the world, and we found that, you know, there was a lack of a vision, there was all sorts of institutional fragmentation, not really sure who's responsible for what, the political incentives were low, technological path dependency, so much money's been spent for 100 years on infrastructure that's no longer relevant, but it's so hard economically, from a financial perspective, to change that. And there's just a lack of experience. So I'll throw in just a little bit of social science, if that's okay. This here, and now the MBAs here might know this curve, this S curve. It's an innovation diffusion curve. And what's happened is quite a lot of sort of sociologists and technologists have gotten together and had a look at major transitions in the past, from the horse and cart to the automobile, from sailing to steam shipping, and said when there's been major transitions that's affected behaviour and economy and strategy, what's happened? And why do programs for more sustainable development often fail? And they found a series of pathways. One is, if you don't take much action, you can take off and have all the policy rhetoric and all the ambition, but if you actually don't follow through with action, you end up with this, what's called this sort of system breakdown. What in Australian cities has happened, and in many North American cities, is that there's been an adoption of this sort of technology without affecting behaviour, without affecting regulation, without affecting policy in any systemic way. And we've made the old approach just a bit more efficient, but we haven't actually transitioned. And then we have plenty of examples, and the Netherlands is a good example, where they had a national policy around wastewater recycling. And a particular region had a bad connection, and there were a couple of houses that were drinking recycled water that wasn't treated properly. And so they've now got a policy ban across the whole country that you can't do recycling. And what that's called is a backlash. And we're seeing backlashes around the world where a new innovative approach just hasn't quite worked. And so politicians are nervous and say, no. So these are real issues. So Melbourne is seen as an exemplar city worldwide in terms of getting to this waterway city, moving from this to this. And so I've had a number of PhD students, and I host a number of researchers from around the world that come and try and understand from a social science perspective why that is the case. And for the political scientists in the audience, understanding governance for sustainable development is actually really important. And traditionally, we've had this sort of top-down governance, this sort of classical political science model of hierarchies and rules and legislation, and that's important. And particularly in Australia and in Europe, the last sort of three decades, we've seen the sort of marketisation approach in government, so putting a price on things and using market incentives to drive behaviours. And so we've seen governance solutions to support sustainable development around sort of taxing and financial incentives. But what we're starting to learn is that if you're wanting to drive sustainable development practices, whether they're water or something else, in fact, the governance paradigm is really important. And in fact, we need to take an innovations approach. We need to invest in, so for the policymakers here, learning processes and networks management. And that's because we don't know what we don't know. You know, we're in an ecosystem of challenges. And I'll give you some examples. So to move from the drain city to the waterway city in Melbourne, there were lots of experiments and happening at different scales and a lot of investment in research but also professional learning. This here is a wall, a fence for a house that's a rain tank. There's some houses that their whole fencing is just a rain tank. Yeah, a way of, you know, innovating in the infrastructure. In Melbourne, there was a lot of investment in co-design and co-management with communities, where communities were designing what this infrastructure should look like, how they want it to feel, what do they want their streetscapes, and how they want this work entering into their private space and into the public space. There was a whole big behaviour change campaign around reducing the amount of water you have, having shorter shower time, so on and so forth. There's a lot of investment in bridging organisations, these temporary organisations that exist for 10, 15 years, and their job was to bring researchers, government, private sector and NGOs together to talk about, so these are process innovations, process experiments, to talk about what the problem might be and how one might go about solving it. So it's not a rule, it's not a piece of legislation, it's not a market incentive, it's an investment in a learning process. And this is difficult for politicians and difficult for heads of government agencies to share power and to be out there and be quite open and to risk failing. To risk failing, that is politically very difficult. There was also some business case examples where different private sector organisations from the land development sector would underwrite a solution and would say, we're going to invest in this solution, and if it doesn't work, we'll underwrite it, government, and we'll rebuild it in the traditional way. And that's because these private sector organisations worked so closely with the researchers, they were convinced that their green technologies would work. This was really important, and this Lynbrook estate, this was built over 10 years ago, and we still have visitors from Malaysia, China, all over Asia that come to Melbourne to visit this site and understand how a relationship happened between researchers and private sectors to stimulate this activity across the city of Melbourne and then across Australia. So We've only just launched, last week actually, a report on how you bring about a transition in more green technology and infrastructure. And it's on that website. And it's a guidance manual specifically for strategists and policymakers. And this is what we found. So we did a number of studies, not just in Australia, we did studies in New Zealand, and we benchmarked and validated our work to cities in the US, two cities in China, and in Singapore. And we found that to go from an old practice, an old way of doing things, to a new sustainable practice, so in this case, big pipes, the big pipes water approach to a water-sensitive city approach, there were six major stages that the government and the community and the private sector needed to go through. We're an issue, and that this here can take about 25 years. We found in other cities it can take 50 years. So the transition, we need to manage our expectations. The transition cannot happen overnight. It takes a sustained period of time. And we developed a simple tool for our industry. So if a water strategist or policymaker in any city wanted to know where their city was at in terms of sustainable water management, they could just do that quite quickly. And what we found is that for those cities that were right in the issue emergence, there would be a group of activists saying, there's a problem, there's a problem, there's a problem. And the mainstream government would be contesting that, saying, no problem. What we found in Melbourne and in Brisbane about 15 years ago, the scientists were saying there's a real problem with waterway health and it's being caused by diffuse stormwater runoff. And major players in government and the land development industry would say, your science is wrong, it's biased. That, and so for people that want to know where their city's at in the transition, think about the narrative. As a city transitions, that network moves beyond just the scientific network. It starts to become a technical coalition and they start developing solutions. So a bit like those green infrastructure solutions, one-off solutions. And they would say, we've got a solution for this problem. But the contesters would say, they've moved beyond the science's bias. They accept it's an issue, but they say your solution doesn't work. No, it doesn't work here, it doesn't work for these soils, it doesn't work for this climate, it doesn't work, you can't build it. When the advocates for a sustainable solution are really starting to make progress, they're not talking about it's a problem anymore, they're not talking about it's what the cause is or the solution, they're now saying, we're not the only ones responsible, you're responsible, you're responsible and you're responsible. Multiple sectors are responsible. And the contesters are saying, that's nice but it's too expensive. So that's where you know you're in this. And you're not really seeing much change on the ground in cities. In fact, the change, practical change, is really happening at, you know, between years 15 and years 25. The advocators are saying there are multiple benefits to these solutions. So green infrastructure, it reduces temperature, it stops flooding, it provides for urban agriculture, it cleans water for supply. The contesters are saying it's not feasible. And when a solution is really starting to take hold, it's no longer a solution for water. So all the people that are the network around the world around water-sensitive cities, they're using the language, this is for a more livable future, a more resilient future. The language has changed from the problem of water. The narrative has changed. So this is a tool that, as researchers, we've developed a shorthand tool for industry to identify where they are, just based on what people are talking about. And I put the website up before, and I can see people are getting a little bit tired, so I won't go into this in too much detail. But we've actually benchmarked and we know what cities need to do specifically to try and catalyse that transition. We know that right at the start you've got issue activists, which are community members and scientists, and we know that once something started to really take hold and starting to tip, You've moved to having an informal policy coalition, right through in the end to something that's a multi-sectoral agency coalition. We know the knowledge questions change. They're really quite traditional science cause-effect questions at the start in this sort of domain, and technological. But really, you're starting to go to capacity building, economic solutions, modelling solutions, and right at the end, the scientists aren't interested anymore. They're off asking the next question. In terms of projects, you're working inside the scientific in laboratories and prototypes to out there having numerous experiments till it's becoming standard practice. And in terms of tools, there's no tools to start with. Then there's some draft guidelines. Really in stage five, you're looking at legislation, market offsets, right through to the end being a political mandate. And so what some of our 86 partners in the CRC doing, they're using this tool to design their transition strategy. So they're saying, right, our city's here. We need to line up and set up these coalitions. We need to do a minor field demonstration. These are the things we need to do to start catalysing that transition. And this is where the social research has been useful in this particular field. So where are we going next with our research in sustainable cities and water? So we've demonstrated these technologies in largely developed settings, and what I mean by that, in reasonably wealthy communities. And we've been approached by a number of partners that have said, cannot this be an approach for upgrading and revitalising slum areas? If slum areas wait for their water servicing, because the big pipes approach, what it means is you've got to go into a slum, you've got to move everyone out, you've got to build the big pipes and maybe bring them back in. And there's nearly a billion slum dwellers in the world. And so we did some back of the envelope calculations. It would take 200 or 300 years before slum dwellers would actually get proper, fair water servicing. So this is our next agenda. We're trying to look at how we can do this in slum contexts. And we've been shortlisted for a Wellcome Trust proposal, and we're pitching to the Wellcome Trust, it's a global health philanthropist, to do this on the 7th of October. And if you have a look at slum upgrading, this is in Kenya here. This is in North Jakarta. So what's happened here in this North Jakarta example, the community were moved out by the World Bank. They didn't come back. Other slum dwellers moved in and they have housing. But they've lost their microeconomic opportunities. So they used to salvage recycled waste and so on and so forth and have small sort of goods preparation in that area. They go and sell at markets and so forth. They've not cleaned up the environment. The area still floods. And it's very expensive. So we think that there is a better way to do slum revitalisation, that they're not dependent on big pipes, not dependent on huge amounts of fossil fuel, and could provide for more amenity and livability. That's our vision. We don't know how to do it yet, but that's where we want to go. This here is a slice of a slum in Indonesia. And you can see here that, you know, flooding is a major problem. We've got all sorts of communicable and non-communicable health diseases, so on and so forth. And this here is an impression my colleague, who's a head of architecture at Monash Melbourne, helped put this together. And this is an alternative way of thinking about how one could revise that slum, provide for cooling, recycling of that water, provide for urban agriculture, so on and so forth. So this is where we're heading next in terms of our ambition. I've got 14 PhD students that have all started last year, all focused on water in Asia from a water-sensitive cities perspective, 7 in the social sciences, 7 in engineering sciences, and they're from all around the world, including a Kay from Malaysia. And so they're part of this next ambition of revitalising slums, dealing with some fundamental issues of disadvantage and water. Very exciting. And this is a small project that, or it's not small, it's actually a large project that we have in Indonesia, where we're contrasting Melbourne, Surabaya and Jakarta in terms of their transition to a water-sensitive city. On that note, I have spoken, believe it or not, for less than an hour, but I'm very happy to take any questions. Thank you.
Oh, thank you very much, Rebekah, and I'm sure you'll stimulate a lot of discussion. Would you like to come and sit down and we'll take the questions? Ah, we already have a question.
I'm...
Is this your bag?
Wushing Kay from... Sunday. And I listened to Prof Brown's brilliant presentation with great interest. I agree completely with all that she said. Especially when she said about political will. A lot of things are not done because political will is not there. There's a lot of political talk, but not political will. And I want to ask her whether she goes in a team to look at Sungai Wei, is a river of our men. Can have a look at it and see what can be done in this part of the Monash Sunway environment and Guinness style and the Carlsberg also there and our university also. Can we do something about Sungai Wei? I have been associated with some effort and finding the river. I hope you look at it and I congratulate the engineering engineers who have become a very hands down and have done good work for Malaysia. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your question. Perhaps I'll address the first part of your question, and then which was about political will, and then I'll address the second part of your question, which I understand was what are the options about what could be done locally here, if I've interpreted that correctly. So that transition curve that I showed with the six steps, what's relevant about that in terms of political will? Where we looked at where sustainable technologies had been diffused, whether they were solar technologies, renewable, sustainable water management, the political will came very late. It was really important that innovators, entrepreneurs, researchers, students tried to do experiments, small projects, joined up action and creating a narrative for a need for change. People in government working in shadow networks, and shadow networks is just social science jargon, that they would coalesce together and try and drive action even though they've got a formal policy role. So there is actually quite a lot that can be done well before political will is generated. And what I learned as a researcher is that to get political will, at least in the examples that I'm familiar with, I cannot talk about Malaysia, I've never done a research project in Malaysia, but to secure political will, politicians need to be confident. They need to know that the solutions are going to work. They need to know that people want it. They need to know there are people out there who can build it. They need to know that their government advisors know what the regulatory setting should be. So they need all of that in place, the how-to, to feel confident to say, to go out there on a limb and say, politically, this is what I'm going to support. That's what I learned was really important. Those steps were really important. So people that are advocates for more sustainable development, sustainable futures, it's a bit of a roadmap to say, yeah, it's going to take some time to generate political will, but these are the things that you need to do in concert. That second question about, well, what could be done here? I mean, this is a question for the whole audience, but it seems to me, with very limited knowledge and very limited appreciation of the challenges and opportunities here, but the whole sort of Sunway precinct is like a urban living laboratory. And there's lots of concrete. Yep. And the opportunity, and there's lots of construction happening as well. So the opportunity for Monash to trial and set up experimental sites as this area keeps redeveloping and monitoring them and demonstrating green technologies or green approaches or more sustainable development systems. And like the electric bus system, it would be perhaps as a living laboratory, it's an urban living laboratory, doing the ecological footprinting, having a look at the emissions that are generated just in this precinct, and working with, I won't go any further than that, I'm just, yeah, I'm sure you've got better ideas than me, but that's my reaction to your question. Oh, there was a lady up there. First.
Thank you very much. I'm working in the community sector, and I'm a sociologist. So I have a very specific question for you. My name is Janet Pilling. In the Malaysian situation, we have interesting division of funding, for example, university funding, research funding, which automatically, you know, tends to promote more and more these days multi-sectoral or, you know, interdisciplinary type work.
Mm-hmm.
But very often the work, although an interdisciplinary team forms theoretically, the work becomes very siloed by the different disciplines, I mean, or the people who do. So my first question is, how do you keep interdisciplinary team together in a university setting, right through a whole project? I understand the common goals and all that, but somehow or other, the output becomes very siloed, and then it's brought together in the report. My second question is, we have a lot of public funds through, I would say, quite innovative government agencies that want to promote sustainability, etc. But the funding approach is on a very short project, quick wins basis. And this, I don't know whether you have faced this problem with government funding, where they want to see the end product too fast. And the time periods that you have mentioned, they understand the need to work in collaboration with policymakers, etc., technologies, etc. But not only is the grant requesting quick wins, the grant is also given more to individuals rather than to collaborative groups. And I don't know whether this is a part of developing, you know, economies or, you know, grant giving in developing countries as opposed to developed countries. Thanks.
Thank you very much for your question. Sorry if I go up there. I've got a slide. I've got a slide to end. I was hoping someone might ask me your first question, and then I'll get to the grants. So, I published this in Nature last year. There was the first time ever this journal had a special issue on interdisciplinarity, And so this is interesting because it's the top journals now that are starting to take the responsibility for driving the... We still need disciplinary research, absolutely. It's critical. But some of the top journals now are saying we need, for these social challenges, which is sustainability is, it's a challenge for people and planet, we need this interdisciplinary research. So I was asked to reflect on the experiences that I was involved in a whole range of multidisciplinary to interdisciplinary projects. And I talked about these sort of five principles for making interdisciplinarity work. And I talk about, this is the graph, this journey to T. And my experience is that you've just got to very quickly understand what academics want to be and want to contribute to interdisciplinarity and which ones don't. There are a lot of academics that want to do the bottom part of the T and just stay monodisciplinary. And you've just got to accept that that's a really valuable contribution, and they just do their monodisciplinary work and not force them into an interdisciplinary model. There are other academics that you can't be interdisciplinary and not be deep in a discipline, that want to have breadth across the top of the T. And you need to know who they are, because there's specific sorts of skills you need to be able to talk across different epistemic communities. And this here is actually not based on any psychological research. This picture is just my opinion, my colleague's opinion. That's all it is, but Nature decided to publish it, so we thought, oh, well, that's good. And what we found in interdisciplinary settings is quite some challenging behaviours. It takes a long time to be a good interdisciplinary citizen in a project. And I suffer from this just as much as other people. So what happens is you come into an interdisciplinary setting, and in water, it just happens to be that the ecologists are often very dominating in my experience, and the political scientists know everything as well. And so what happens is people come in to this, and it's a problem fundamentally with our education knowledge systems over the last couple of hundred years. You can graduate a lawyer and never be exposed to the paradigms of science, engineering, medicine. We're not exposed to how the other disciplines think. We don't need to know the depth of it, but we're not exposed in our basic education. And even you could go in and do an arts degree in social sciences and then do a PhD in social science and never once be exposed to the norms of law or the norms of physical sciences and the paradigms. So you've got to learn. So most people, when they come into an interdisciplinary setting, think that what they learnt and what they see as the paradigms of good quality thinking and research, well, that's the right way of doing it. So you come into an interdisciplinary, and I've got my engineering hat on, and engineering says you've got to do a controlled experiment that way, and external validity happens that way. What are you talking about, political scientists? That's just what people think. That's not real research. So there is, you know, and, you know, so there's this. And so what happens is I see new, when people are new to an interdisciplinary environment and they've got goodwill, they come in and they dominate with their knowledge and their behaviours are quite aggressive. But what happens after, and I go through this too, what happens after a little while, they realise that they don't know everything and they get really passive and really quiet and then don't contribute as well, which is not good. And so this diagram here is to show that it takes a while. And people who are more experienced in being interdisciplinary need to help the new people and be really generous for the new people contributing in this space, because it takes a while to build that constructive dialogue skills. But we don't teach it. The higher education system does not teach how to be interdisciplinary, and we still produce people that are monodisciplinary without appreciation of how their knowledge sits relative to others. And I think this is a big challenge the education and knowledge sector has for bringing about a more sustainable world, let alone, you know, so having a common mission, people signing up to a common mission and a value base, looking at the impact of that research, having impact conversations as a way of getting different disciplines together. And I'm happy to talk more about this. But the second part of your question, which was about grants, this is really difficult. So that journey I showed, that Monash University journey for urban water, quite a lot of that money early on was not traditional research council money. It was often industry money. And the researchers had to work really hard at doing the industry applied work, but setting it up smartly to be able to ask research questions and publish while doing that. And I acknowledge that's just really, really difficult and really, really challenging. With this CRC, the Cooperative Research Centre in Australia, this was an initiative of a few prime ministers ago who said we actually need to provide incentives for end-user driven research. So you needed to have partners that said, I've got a practical problem, policy, practice, community, and we're going to invest in research with universities, and they're going to have to address that practical problem. The challenge was is that some CRCs have got people working in impact and practice, but not actually asking the critical research questions and the implementation research questions around that. But to be able to do that, you have to be able to do interdisciplinary research. So it can get a little bit chicken and egg. But we need funders to fund fundamental disciplinary research. It's not either or. It's just that the pie needs to open up, I think. I don't have an answer to that question, just to share with the pain with you of that.
Okay, Rebekah, I did not hear you talk about the economics of some of these measures. Obviously, they must be costing a lot of money, and how much are they, I don't know. And can that be a very serious constraint for the wider adoption of these measures?
Yeah, so we have a large ecological economics team, and in fact they only came into this research sphere in the last 5 years, actually, because we couldn't, we had to demonstrate what the environment and social benefits were of sustainable water management so that they could then be valued. And so the economists have been really important in developing valuation algorithms to value the financial, ecological and social costs and benefits of these systems. And there needed to be enough systems built to be able to rigorously compare them, the financial, ecological and social costs compared to the traditional systems. The other work that the economists have been really helpful in helping us understand is that Treasury Department, so, you know, your Prime Minister would have a Department of Treasury that looks after financing and what would be funded. All the government agencies would typically put their bids into Treasury to get money for their next year or two's budget. And people in Treasury want very, very solid business cases. And the challenge is that they want to see that this stuff works in the ground and works really well. Otherwise, for them, the business case is not there. And so it's very hard to be innovative and then to get something through Treasury. And the only way to get in the Australian and the New Zealand situation, the only way to get something through Treasury is you needed a politician to say, I want it to happen. Then you don't need the business case like you traditionally do. So it becomes quite circular. But the economists in our team were really helpful to help us understand that political economy dynamic. And so that's when we understood how you need to build enough track record and people in the system to give some political political confidence. So the economists spent time looking at the costs, the financial costs of the traditional systems, and then it comes a value judgment. What you're arguing is the value and the benefit, and you've got to be persuasive. And this comes down to politics, this comes down to narrative and telling a joined-up story. So this is where economists are being artists. really. It's the art. You know, what are you valuing? What are you budgeting? What are you saying is a cost or not? And that can be quite subjective. But we were working with economists that are, I suppose, like ecological economists and had this sort of value set. So I don't have a straight answer. I mean, you're asking how much do these systems cost? And that question is relative to what, to a traditional way of doing the system. We would argue that over a long period of time, the fact that these systems can be built in a modular way, the fact that they reduce the urban heat island, they provide for more amenity, they provide an opportunity for urban agriculture and cleaning water in the landscape. They're incredibly financially efficient. But this might be the same here, but in the Australian system, you look at what are the efficiencies in health? What are the efficiencies in environment? What are the efficiencies in infrastructure? So it's got to fit into a particular bucket, but many of these sustainable development solutions cut across all those buckets, and the economic algorithms are per bucket. And so you're trying to build a business case that actually there's all these multiple benefits, but they'll be comparing what it costs for water supply, the old water supply versus the new water supply. But these systems just don't deliver an additional source of water supply. They all these other benefits. So it's very difficult.
So, Rebekah, are there examples from around the world that people like you can now use and say, yes, well, this is what's been done, or is it just so new that we don't have those examples yet?
Yeah, there's examples. Yep, there's definitely so examples around the world.
There's financial examples.
Yeah.
You can use to sell what you want to do.
Yep. Yep.
Like, what would be your number one
This is not a financial example, yeah. But the number one example that is most relevant here would probably be what's happening in Singapore, because it's close. The geological context is not so different. Your leaders could visit it easily. It's not too far away, and it is part of their ABC program, being active, beautiful and clean. Obviously, it's different political context and so on and so forth.
But 50 years ago, we were the same, so.
Yeah. And I'm not saying, though, that some of the water solutions in Singapore aren't very energy intensive, particularly the wastewater recycling, but in terms of this particular example that's been built all over Singapore, that would be a very relevant example, but it's been underwritten by the government, by the Public Utilities Board. Yeah.
Can I ask the last question? I would like to ask whether the Faculty of Engineering at Monash and the seven handsome men and women who stood up on the screen, will they be back to work on the research on some way
I can't speak on behalf of the engineering researchers at Monash Melbourne. Certainly Professor Anna Delatech, who's the Associate Dean Research in Engineering, her and her team have developed a lot of these technologies. She's been a long-term collaborator of mine. But also there's the CRC for Water Sensitive Cities, led by Professor Tony Wong, that are doing this sort of work outside of Australia, and Singapore's one of those examples. So I think that it would be great that and Monash Malaysia might already, I think, be working with Monash Melbourne on this. I'm not sure of the detail, but I think there's enough people here that might be able to follow that up.
Yeah, we've had a study done by a student in the School of Science some years ago, actually, just an ecological study.
Okay. Sorry, I can't see who's next.
I'm a media and communication student, and I was curious about one thing. we live in a world where global warming is still a debate, and we have politicians like Donald Trump and Sarah Palin insisting that global warming doesn't really exist. It's all wind, it blows all over the place, and it's not really man-made, it's just a natural cycle. Sometimes it's hot, sometimes it's cool, and we have doomsday scientists from Stanford, like the latest research I read by a person called Paul Ehrlich, his name is spelled E-H-R-L-I-C-H. He says that the current rate of biodiversity is being eliminated. Humans have roughly three more generations on Earth, and he says he's using conservative estimates, so it's more likely to be less. So in a world where most people don't care about the environment and global warming is still a debate, do you feel like you're fighting for a lost cause, trying to save a world where humans are destroying it far more efficiently than scientists can save it?
Well, I can tell you're going to be a great journalist when you graduate. Great question. Gosh. Well, I'm half cup full rather than half cup empty. And we all move in different networks and in different circles. I think what gives me hope is we have a look at the finance sector around the world. And what the finance sector, particularly the early adopters in the finance sector, are saying, and please, I'm not an expert on this. This is not my expertise. I'm giving you my opinion. This is not an evidence-based answer from a study. But leaders in the finance sector are saying climate change is a material financial risk to productivity. It's not about nice environment and hugging trees and helping poor people. They're saying it is a material financial risk, and there is a, for want of a better word, a divestment movement happening across the world where major fund managers are looking at screening investments in terms of making sure that they're not investing in companies who are dependent on making money out of fossil fuels. And we're starting to see that shift. So if the financial keepers, the big financial keepers of the world, are seeing climate change as a material financial risk to productivity, then I think that's a sign that the non-impassioned sectors in the world are accepting that this is a material risk and seeing it as affecting their bottom line, then we're moving outside of the doomsday and the advocates conversation. And I'm anticipating that this is just going to grow and grow and grow. But I don't know, yeah? But that's what I see. Thanks for your question.
Hi, Professor Brown. Thank you for the enlightening talk. My question is rather simple. It's regarding, as you mentioned earlier, that converting a city from a water channel, from a water channel city to a more water sensitive city, it takes quite a bit of time. And considering the issues about the climate changes here, especially in the Malaysian context, we have more heat wave, and our country is suffering from a shift between a heat wave where lakes are drying up to the point where there's a sudden downpour in water, creating floods all over this country. Would you advocate that more drastic measures like geological engineering will be a possible way to address the water management issues in Malaysia as well?
Okay, that's another good question. So caveat, I'm not an expert on the Malaysian context. So we know regionally and globally that we're going to have more heat waves, more droughts and more floods as a result of global climate change. Yep. Over 90% of the world's scientists all agree on this. This is a phenomena. So then the question is how... The question is how do we adapt to that? And how do we mitigate the effects of global climate change? And you're asking now, how do you, what do you do for water management specifically in Malaysia to address that? And so... Actually, my colleague here might want to answer your question.
Sorry, I couldn't help but say replant our forests, because what we're doing is we're cutting them down and it is just so, so bad. You know, here we are, we're suffering from lack of water and our very source of water is being destroyed. As I speak, it's being destroyed and it's, you know, the KLORR is going through my forest by my house. We're having trees being cut down across Malaysia, across Sarawak, across Sabah, and it's disastrous for our water management. You know, that's number one. Save our water supplies.
Okay. Thank you, Professor Rebecca, for the presentation. My name is Andreas. I'm a PhD student on civil engineering. And basically, I'm actually studying just nice about the biofiltration stuff. And Prof Anna itself is actually my course professor on this. So I wouldn't ask about the technical thing, but then I would ask about more towards the support. Because in Melbourne, I have been told, so I know about how the experiment going on for there. And we know it's actually fully supported by the government as well, so they help for that. But in our case in Malaysia, it's a bit different, as there is one already biofiltration swales actually built in around place USM, which is one of the universities in Malaysia. But the results of that doesn't really actually give much benefits to the environment, and after that, they actually doesn't really have any improvement on that matter, and it's just left there. So I'm wondering what we can do here, as someone would actually doesn't really much supported by the government, I would say, but because this one is like a private university. So how much you can do to actually be part of this leapfrog from the towards the water-sensitive city.
Thank you. Another difficult question. Well, I understand that forecourt entrance area of this campus is going to be rebuilt and reconstructed soon, and there's going to be a whole lot of new roofing structures as well. I don't know if that's right. That was explained to me today. Now, you've got a whole lot of redevelopment that's going to happen on this campus, and I know it's the Sunway Architects working with the Monash consultants. I think I understand that correctly. This is the opportunity to build your biofilters, to build these green walls, to, as living laboratories for the university, and so you can have your policy science students looking at it, your engineering students are looking at it, your business students looking at all sorts of different technologies that may have taken off around Malaysia over the last decade, and use those lessons to apply to these technologies to look at how they might be able to be incentivized and take off. It's not a comprehensive answer, but maybe you and your student colleagues could get together and say, actually, when we're redeveloping campus, it would be really great if we had these features in the designs. I think Helen's probably going to...
Helen says yes.
So I think that doing something local and on this space, and it could be an exemplar for the Sunway precinct and a way of Monash students engaging with the Sunway architects, so you could coalesce and form. It would probably be good if you had a sustainable development solutions youth network here, and if you got together as a youth network, because the youth network at Monash Melbourne is very, very strong, and they turn up to lots of things and are very opportunistic in trying to affect change around the redevelopment, landscaping, whatever, at the university, right through to investment policy of the university. And so don't underestimate the power of student energy and student voice. I'm not mean to be putting the responsibility back on you, but I'm just, you know.
Yeah, here we have Monash Green Steps, and it's time to step it up.
Related to how in your presentation you address cities, but is there a focus by you or anyone else, and is it integrated in terms of rural areas? Since we know so much, I guess, of water use is in agriculture, water wastes in animal agriculture, as Kathy mentioned before, deforestations, I guess this is such a huge issue, and is, I guess, is a different approach needed for that area, or can you, I guess, link it together with cities?
Thanks for your question. This research story that I spoke about is explicitly about cities and urban water, and that's been a very vacuous space policy-wise and research-wise, probably globally. There's been a lot of attention on agriculture and water, and certainly not enough in the rural space. So I don't really know what to say, because this is about people and infrastructure working in a way to improve ecological servicing of a city. So the analogy can be there for agriculture in terms of choosing the right agriculture that meets that that particular biophysical conditions, and doing agriculture in a way that minimises use of throughput of resources, maximises yield, important for productivity. But I'm sort of going to the point of, you know, this comes down to land use policy and how one uses their land. Governments use land in the best possible way for its people and the planet. And then that gets into big debates around waterways, biodiverse areas, forests, and room for agriculture. And so that sort of, and this is a space that ecologists, particularly natural ecologists, have a strong role to play, but also understanding cultural landscape and the role of agrarian societies and how we've developed that. And agriculture is really usually quite a big part of a nation's economic portfolio, and it's often very important for national productivity. And so the economic and political questions in that are obviously extremely complex. I'm not an expert in that, and I certainly think there are definitely analogies, but perhaps the biggest link between that sort of rural idea and the urban idea is cities becoming more sufficient, because urban agriculture is not a phenomena really anywhere. It's just patches of it. And so we rely on agriculture outside of cities to provide the throughput of resources to sustain cities. And urban agriculture is a political act in the sense that it can potentially reduce that dependency on rural agriculture. And that brings into question, how do you use your land more sustainably? But we're yet to see that.
Yeah, I'd just like to add one thing to that. But we need to have riparian zones along, as an ecologist, riparian zones along every river. We need to have natural vegetation, be it through an urban area or through rural area, and if you protect our rivers with natural vegetation, it'll make a huge difference to both flooding, pollution, everything. It's just vast improvement, and it improves the quality of life. If we have vegetation, you know, looks better.
Yeah.
Okay, well, I think we'd better finish because it's already a bit over time. I'd like to invite Prof. Helen, who's, there she is, to present a token of our appreciation to Rebekah. So thank you very much for a very enlightening talk. Thank you.